Flawless.
He was going to play Shelley's the week, I guess that was it. He was booked in and they closed down. Oscar Peterson.
That really was a beautiful. Yeah. You know, I heard Oscar Peterson Thursday night and played with Ray Brown Friday night.
I was surprised somebody got booking
came
him down.
Back and heard the Modern Jazz Quartet.
Our in-person guest, the music of Hampton Hawes. Hampton, another beautiful composition of yours. Once again, the title, so our audience will know it.
Oh, that was called Rainforest.
Mm-hmm. You know what, Hampton...
excuse me, Gerald, we got a little buzz from the front office. I got a lot of calls, and we didn't say the name of the book often enough, nor the publisher often enough for most folks to get it. So, Hampton, can we do that again? It's Raise Up Off Me is the name of the book. And the publisher is who?
Coward McCann.
And Joe Chan, is that how you pronounce that?
No, Gohagan.
Gohagan.
It's G-E-O-G-H-E-G-A-N. Coward McCann and Gohagan.
So C-M and G, I suppose.
Yeah, C-M-G is the initials, and it's a firm publishing house out of New York, Madison Avenue.
All right.
Raise Up Off Me.
Right, maybe we'll save some more calls over there.
Very good. And about his book, too, once again, anything you want to get over about... in fact, I think off mic, a very good question was just asked by a good friend of ours, John Hunt, who happens to be in the studio with us today. And he was asking you, Hampton, what did you expect to really get across, or what would the public get from your book? What did you want to portray, you know, get to them?
Honesty, and also, actually, I wanted people to enjoy it, and from the people that I've talked to that have read the book so far, too much. Nobody never went through all that in their life, but it's actually the truth, you know.
Hampton, how did your association with President Kennedy come about? That's a...
Well, that's one of the dramatic points. I received executive clemency from President Kennedy. I was the second person to get it before he got killed. And what's strange is all kind of weird parallels. You know, I was in Fort Worth, you know, and trying to get my life together after being strung out for 9 years. And I had a 10-year sentence. You know, I did about 5 years down there, you know. And so I filed clemency. Now, here's a man that... you know, like that had all that stuff on his shoulder, you know, trying to run the country and the world and get along with the Chinese and the Russians, and his wife just had a baby and the baby died, and he gave me executive clemency, and then I was 63 August. In November of the same year, he got assassinated about 100 yards, about close enough, you know, about 2 miles from the window. I could have saw him go by where I was, where he let me out.
Yeah.
So I said, now here's a man that's dedicated, you know, that gave me a new life, you know, got my message, you know, and then he goes down, you know, he gets murdered, actually. So that in itself, I said, well, I can't ever half step no more. I got to keep stepping, because if a man that great can die, you know, actually, like, for the people, you know, for trying to be a good man and take care of the people, well, I at least owe it to him to try and dedicate my life to good music and tell the truth and, you know, be friends with people and try to, you know, make it a happier world. That's what I think.
Beautiful words. I didn't know about that. Glad to hear that, Hampton. Hampton, you know one thing. Now, we're going to get back to some more music. I picked up an album. I'm just picking them up at random now because, you know, I've known you for a long time. And one thing we're going to ask you about before we get into another thing, you've been writing quite a bit quite a few original compositions lately. I don't remember before you doing an awful lot of composing. Did this come about as a spur of the moment thing, or were you doing it before but just you were not recording it?
Well, actually, Gerald, what I think happened was a slow transition, a gradual slow transition over the years. You know, like in the 50s when everybody was playing so-called, quote, bebop, they would take standard tunes, you know, they'd play tunes like All the Things You Are, and they'd play tunes like I Got Rhythm, How High the Moon,
yeah.
Or they'd take a lot of tunes by writers that wrote tunes for Broadway shows, and they would put jazz licks on them, or sometimes they'd write a whole series and call it another tune, like Hot House is actually what's this thing called, you know what I mean? And I think that what I was trying to do was learn how to improvise on those tunes, and those were the tunes everybody was playing, you know. And then as I got older and became more mature, I started saying, well, I'd find myself once in a while getting into a certain pattern, because a lot of those tunes had certain patterns, and I'd find myself getting into certain patterns where I would ad-lib almost identically on those, on the pattern in one tune I would do on the other. So I said, well, why don't I write some of my own tunes, and maybe I have to play something different to keep up with them, you know.
Yeah.
And then I tried it, and it, you know, it worked pretty good. So now, you know, I'm writing more music now than I ever did in my life.
Uh-huh. Well, you know what, Hampton, I was just wondering, this album here in 1967, which must have been about 7 years ago, and you were in Europe, and the very number that you happened to mention, you recorded, what is this thing called, Love, which you mentioned is Hot House, a number written by Ted Dameron.
Right, right.
And just like, if you don't mind, for our audience today to go back 7 years ago and see how what you were into right then.
Okay.
And featured with you here, some young musicians from Europe, Eberhard Weber on bass, I believe, and Klaus Weiss on drums. And of course, our in-person guest, Hampton Hawes, on piano. Right. I just have to pick up that album. I love to hear him play, you know. And I know.
It's a good one. He's good bass player. Billy Joe Jones was supposed to make this album with me. And he missed the plane, so I showed up. The first part of the album don't have no drums, because we had to wait for a cat to drive in a truck from Stuttgart.
Yeah, that's funny.
Stuttgart. So while he was doing it, we cut half the album with a duet. When he got there, the other half was trio. So there's no drums on this one.
And I think so.
Good bass player too.
Yeah, I've heard about him. He's like, they fight for you two for quite a while.
You know what he was doing? He was working as a travel agent.
Is that right?
A truck driver. It's far out. The things musicians got to do to survive.
Right, yeah, it's really something. It's true. I bet Hampton photographs well, huh? He has a very photogenic face, huh?
I tell you, everybody that comes through here has got an incredible face. It's really...
Yeah, you should see what kind of face we had him.
Oh, yeah, I know that was
green.
Beautiful.
Yeah, it really was.
I know that was beautiful.
But I know he's really good, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you know, maybe we get a chance, we can show him sometime.
Yeah, I'd like to see that.
You're recording this on video.
Yeah, I know. He told me that's good, because you're making history. You're making history, and it should go down. You know, I was just telling you.
We're gonna do some more, because by the time we get to that,
I had some pictures that in the 50s that I just put out in the garage, and when I went to the army, I came back and they just disappeared. You know, I don't know whether the dog ate them up or cobwebs, and I had pictures of birds. I had pictures of Miles. I had pictures of Billie Holiday.
One
was saved, and I got it framed, a little picture of me and Billie Holiday when I was playing with Red Norville in 1947. And I got on a big old funny band coat, because the coat they gave me was too big and the shoulders falling down. And she had her arms around when we was taking a picture together. You know, I got that. But if I'd have saved those other pictures, you can imagine that, shoot, they could... probably could reproduce them and put them in some kind of encyclopedia just for pictures of people, you know. Not pictures of them playing, I mean, just of walking down the street. You know, I had a picture of Bird and Wardell at a hot dog stand on Avalon. Somebody just took, you know.
Yeah.
Chuck Thompson, I think, took it, you know.
You don't realize what these pictures mean to you.
Johnny Otis called me. He's got a lot of pictures. He said of me that I didn't even know he had. You know, he said he got a lot of pictures.
We don't think anything of these pictures, you know.
There's a chair.
And then later on you said, gee, I wish I had that photograph.
Well, we were talking about that before, about the video, you know. And
that
you're the only cat doing that right now, and you're in a position, in your position, you know.
Well, we're not sure how to do it right, you know, what we're trying to do. Obviously, like he said, we're honest about what we're doing.
I had one of Paul Chambers, Philly Joe Jones, Frank Butler, Lawrence Marable, Coltrane, and myself, and Red Garland. I had a little back room on 46th Street. We were all sitting back there jamming and drinking and having a good time. And there wasn't no brushes, and Philly Joe Jones was playing on the stool with whisperings while Paul was playing the bass, you know. I guess what it was is those people back there, nobody actually didn't realize how important what they were doing. You know what I'm saying? As far as history, you know, they were just thinking, well, we make a gig, and we knew, you know, like the musicians knew who was cool, but we never did think that.
Do you know Dizzy Gillespie and Ray Brown, Milt, Al Haig, Al Keeney? And they were playing down on Vine Street. I was recording for Otis Rene, but I was a good friend of Norman Grant. So he says to me, he says, what do you think of these two guys? I said, these two men would be the biggest name the jazz ever had.
Right.
And he took me up on it, and he signed them up, as you notice.
Right.
Ladies and gentlemen, there, the artistry of our in-person guest. We've just heard him there from a performance, 1967, doing what is this thing called Love, the Cole Porter composition with real spaced out changes. You know what, Hampton, when we go back to 67, we can see how beautiful now, though, that the bebop era really is, because today is just as fresh with those beautiful minor sevenths and sharp nines and augmented elevenths and minor sevenths and flat fives and
right,
all of that stuff.
Right. You know, the way I look at it is that all the music evolves, all the music keeps evolving, and all good music will never become dated. You know, you can listen to Charlie Parker now, you can listen to Betsy Smith, you can listen to Jelly Roll Martin, you know.
Right.
You know, even look at now what's popular, Scott Joplin is popular,
right.
You know. That
right.
Cat probably lived in 1720 something, but it's still cool because he could play and the music was good, you know.
Uh-huh.
And I had a musician say, well, don't you think that the more modern music is hipper? I said, listen. He was asking me about if the far-out music or avant-garde. I say, avant-garde's been here all the time. Listen to Stravinsky. He wrote something 30 years ago. And I still don't understand that, but it's still nice. And I like avant-garde music. All music is groovy, you know.
Music is avant-garde at some time, too.
That's right. Look at Bartok and Debussy, you know.
Yeah.
Shoot, Jelly Roll Martin would do some things that would be far out.
You know what, Hampton, speaking, you might be of interest. This might interest you, too. You know, in Sedalia, Missouri is a place where Scott Joplin used to perform all of the time. Mm-hmm. And he performed in a saloon there called the Maple Leaf.
Oh, yeah.
Like a ballroom and saloon. And, of course, that's where he wrote his most famous rag composition, the Maple Leaf Rag.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? They're having a four-day rag festival in that town just because of the fact that he used to work in the town.
Ain't that something? I bet you was getting $2 a week and two beers, and nobody knew it when he was doing it.
Well, one thing they knew, Hampton, they knew that there was something to Scott Joplin, because you know Scott Joplin was a star at the 1904 World's Fair.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
And of course, he was a big man all of his life.
Oh, he was.
He had a little trouble then trying to present his rag opera, which they began to say, well, you know, Scott and I, he wants to get in.
Too sophisticated.
But do you know, in fact, I just might have it here today. I usually, and I really didn't expect to have it with me, but I just happened to cut it out of a magazine a few years ago. Let's see if it has the date around here, if I can see. November 1st, 1971. And the title of this article out of Newsweek is King of Rag. And the reason is because they were just performing this particular rag that he was trying to get performed in Atlanta, Georgia to a sellout crowd.
Wow.
Now, isn't that something?
Yeah.
It was 1971. Of course, you know, last year his music in the Sting was the hit of the year. Anyway, what do you think of ragtime, by the way? Do you play any of that on the piano?
Well, I used to play Boogie Woogie. That's how I got my left hand cool.
Because
I used to listen to, you know, I used to listen to Earl Hines, and I used to listen to Jelly Roll Martin, and Pete Johnson, and Albert Adams.
Right.
And Freddie Slack, and all those cats used to play Boogie Woogie, so I used to try and practice Boogie Woogie with my right hand. But I never did play rag because of... I'm beginning to play tenth now, or stride piano now, you know. In fact, the fella that wrote the book with me, Don Escher, he can play rag real good. He can really play it. He can play it better than me, but because he used to do that all the time. He used to do it all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But out of Boogie Woogie, playing Boogie Woogie, then when it came time to play, when you're playing chords and have a bass player and stuff, well, it made my left hand stronger, you know. So now I can play just as good with my left hand as I can with my right. So by playing Boogie Woogie really helped me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I like it.
Mm-hmm. Do you think you might even now, since the rag is out, you might even play a couple of things maybe sometime at one of your performances?
You know what? I'm home right now practicing Boogie Woogie. Because I heard Oscar Peterson last week, and he's playing solo now. I heard him at the El Matador. And... don't you know, he struck out and started playing Boogie Woogie for about 3 minutes and brought the whole house down.
yeah. In other words, you know what, do you find that the Boogie Woogie was one of the greatest extensions into piano styles really ever, because it really added to a moving rhythm?
Right. Mm-hmm. I think that it has something really that, some kind of innate connection with shuffle rhythm too. You remember Louis Jordan's band,
right,
the shuffle rhythm?
Right.
That's awful close. Well, the whole band was doing it. The drummer was making the beat.
Right, right.
You know, I think there was a, I think it was a righteous tie-in.
Yeah. You know what, ladies and gentlemen, we're talking with Hampton Hawes, and we do a little bit of talking and a little bit of music. Hampton,